Welcome to this lecture. In this short lecture, we will discuss about emitter follower circuits using a single BJT and a Darlington pair. So this is primarily to understand about this emitter follower circuit so that the experiment on emitter follower circuits can be done. So the aim of the experiment is to design and test an emitter follower circuit to determine the gain, input impedance and output impedance under two cases. One is with bootstrapping, another one is without bootstrapping. And again, we have to do in two cases, one for a single BJT and another for a Darlington pair. So let us understand things one by one. The very first thing is, let us try to understand what is this emitter follower circuit. From your theory classes, you would have known that this emitter follower is nothing but a common collector amplifier configuration. So it is basically a common collector configuration. So in comparison with MOSFET, this is similar to a common drain amplifier, where you would have seen that the gain of a common drain amplifier in the case of MOSFET is very close to unity. A similar way, in the case of BJT based amplifiers also, for a common collector, the voltage gain is very less, or it is very close to unity. So if you look at the common collector configuration, what we can understand is input will be given to the base, output will be taken from the emitter. So I'll just put a resistance over here as the load resistance, and the collector is kept as common. So when we say common, collector is common for your input signal. For small signal picture, collector will be common. For in order to maintain the proper operating point of the transistor, collector should be connected to VCC. Now, so since voltage is input is given to base and output is taken from emitter, and from the analysis, we will come to know that the voltage gain is approximately equal to 1. What we can say is here, emitter is actually following what is there at the base. And for that reason, we call as emitter, since emitter is output is following input, or since emitter is emitter follows input, we call this as emitter follower. That is the reason why we call this as an emitter follower circuit. Right. So this experiment, so as we discussed in the case of a common drain amplifier, in the case of MOSFET, it is generally used whenever we need to match impedance. So for example, when we want to match a high impedance source to a low impedance load, we use common drain or common collector configurations in between. And that is when we use a single BJT. But when we go for something called as Darlington pair is actually cascading of two BJTs. We'll see how a Darlington structure looks like. Basically, this will, the common or regular structure itself will give you high input impedance. But in, when you do Darlington pair, or when we configure in the form of Darlington pair, the input impedance will be much more. So before coming and looking at the circuit diagram in detail, let us write some of the important features of this common collector amplifier or emitter follower. So the detailed analysis should be, it is already done in the class, or you can refer to the previous lectures to know more about this. Now here in this lecture, we will directly take the results what we have. So if you write the, if you look at the voltage gain expression, what you will get to know is the voltage gain of common collector amplifier or emitter follower is basically Re divided by small Re plus capital Re. This can be made in comparison with what you learned for MOSFET, or this can be otherwise written as Re is nothing but 1 by GM. So we can write this as GM Re divided by 1 plus GM Re. So by looking at the expression for voltage gain, we can directly say that the voltage gain is voltage gain is very close to unity. So I'll just write that over here. This is one of the important result of a common collector amplifier. Voltage gain is very close to 1. Now, looking at the input impedance, so when you have only this structure, we can actually evaluate input impedance from this side. And when you evaluate, you can actually follow the regular method what we do. And from the results, we can directly write that the input impedance will be equal to beta plus 1 into small re plus capital R. This also can be actually derived. So if you have any questions on this, please go back and refer to the previous lectures where we have actually derived these results, beta plus 1 into small re plus capital R. Similarly, for the output, output impedance is generally seen from the output side. And since we can directly say the impedance seen up is RE, small RE, and the impedance seen down is capital RE. So the output impedance can be directly written as the value will be small RE parallel to capital RE. So these are the important results what we should know before we go about this, before we look at this amplifier simulations. All right, so with this result, what we can say is input impedance is actually high and output impedance is low. Thereby, we call this as a buffer. The structure, we call it as a buffer, which can actually, since the input impedance is high, this can connect a source of high impedance. And since the output impedance is low, this can actually match that high impedance source to this low impedance load, right? So here the impedance seen is high, so it can be easily connected to a high impedance source. Now here the impedance seen is low, this can be easily connected with the low impedance load without any loading. And what it does is, since it can give maximum gain of 1, the whatever is the voltage, this will be buffered by proper impedance matching. All right, now let us look at the circuit what we have actually set up for the lab. The same so if you look at the circuit diagram, just to understand about this, so here we have the transistor is here. The collector is actually connected to VCC for proper biasing. Now at the emitter, you can see that there is a resistance, right? So this is what generally we will see whenever we study about small signal analysis. But now when you do this in lab, we will not bring in multiple supplies to bias the transistor. Rather, we will use biasing resistor. So what you can see here is, in order to bias the base, you can see that two resistors, R1, R2 resistors, are connected through RB, and that is actually connected to the base, which is actually providing you the proper biasing, right? Apart from that, you can see that at the input, we have added a resistance and a capacitor, which will definitely eliminate some of the noise. Now, the rest components, what you will see is, one is a capacitor at the output, which will definitely couple the emitter node to the output. So the output, the signal is taken through this coupling capacitor at the emitter. And one more capacitance, what you can see is here, 100 microfarad capacitance, which is marked as CBS, where this capacitor is otherwise called as bootstrap capacitor. So the CBS capacitor is otherwise called as bootstrap capacitor. All right. Now, what we do here is, we take the circuit. After understanding the operation, we will perform the simulation and evaluate the input impedance, output impedance, and so on, right? So what you can see here is, there is a switch kept over here, and the switch is initially kept off, or the switch is open. That means there is no connection from output to the input. So the bootstrap capacitor, how it helps us, it is actually connecting from output back to input. Thereby, this bootstrapping effect is actually giving some high input impedance. We will see how that high input impedance is actually achieved in the circuit. Now, from this point, so at the base of this transistor, we know that the input impedance is beta plus 1 into small Re plus capital R. This is what we have derived. But now, since the source is connected here, this is the point where we connect the source. And now, when we measure input impedance, actually the input impedance should be measured from this point. Now, if you look at this, even though the transistor, when you're looking at the base of the transistor, even though the transistor is having a high input impedance, which is beta plus 1 into Re plus Re, the biasing resistors, especially the resistors R1 and R2, is basically it is limiting the input impedance of the transistor, because you can see that the if you look at the base of the transistor, the resistance is beta plus 1 into Re plus Re. But when you actually measure the input impedance, because the input source is here, when you measure input impedance from this point, you can see that there is some resistance here, and that is in parallel to the resistance seen here, right? So if you write the input impedance for this circuit, I can say that beta plus 1 into small Re plus capital Re is coming in parallel with RB, and this R1 and R2 are in parallel. You can see that R1 R2 are in, will be in parallel when we draw the small signal equivalent circuit. So R1 and R2 are in parallel, and from there you will see that RB resistance will be coming in series. So this will be the input impedance of the circuit, including the biasing transistors, right? Now, if you look at this, even though the input impedance is high at the base, which is beta plus 1 into Re plus Re, the input impedance of the circuit at the input terminals, which is somewhere here, it is basically determined, or it is limited by the biasing resistors, which is RB, R1, and R2, right? So how it is limited? Because beta plus 1 Re plus Re is the actual input resistance, but now this biasing resistance value is coming in parallel with this, and thereby this is actually reducing the input impedance of the circuit. Reducing R, this is actually reducing R. Now, what are we doing here is, we cannot eliminate biasing resistors because we need to bias a circuit. At the same time, we do not want to compromise on the input impedance part. So what we will do here is, with the help of this, this switch, by connecting a capacitance from the output node, and by closing this switch, and by connecting that to this node, we are actually trying to overcome this limitation in the input impedance, which is primarily caused by the biasing resistance. So just to understand that analytically, I'm just marking this as the output node Vout, and this is the point where, right? So I'm connecting. So this node will, since it is shorted, this also will be Vout. A Vin is connected here, so this can be also, this can be seen as the input node, right? So what we'll do is, we will try to look at the input impedance here. So how will I find the input impedance? Now what I have done, I'm just closing the switch, and I'm closing the switch, this bootstrap capacitor is actually coming into picture. Now when that comes into picture, you will see that the input impedance, or this limitation of this input impedance of the transistor by this biasing resistors, will be overcome with the help of this bootstrap resistor. So how will I do that? In order to do that, let me write what is this. I'm just trying to find the input impedance at this point. So if I write that, I can write input current is equal to, with the bootstrapping, so this is actually without bootstrapping, this is without bootstrap. Now with the bootstrap, with bootstrap capacitance, where you have established a connection from output back to input, if I evaluate Iin, how can I write Iin? Iin can be written as, this node is actually Vin minus, I'm just looking at this path alone, neglecting the base current, so Vin minus Vout divided by the resistance is RB. If I'm neglecting base current, I can write that just I'm measuring the input impedance at this point. So Vin minus Vout divided by RB will be Iin, right? So because we already know what is impedance here, I'm just finding the impedance in this path. Both are coming in parallel. That is what we have already here, right? But with the bootstrapping, how this inference is getting modified is what we are trying to understand here. So how can I write this? I can write this as I'll take V in common. So it will be 1 minus V out by V in is nothing but the voltage gain here divided by RB. Or if I rearrange this, I can write this as V in divided by I in can be written as, if I rearrange it, will be RB divided by 1 minus AV. This is the impedance, right? This is the impedance in, so previously, in the previous case, this was the impedance which was coming in parallel, but now this impedance is modified by this, by the bootstrap connection. So what I'm going to do now is I'm just rewriting the input impedance here. If I rewrite the input impedance, I can write it as R in with bootstrapping can be written as beta plus 1 into small Re plus capital Re, which is the resistance seen at the base of the transistor, in parallel with RB divided by 1 minus AV. That is what we have derived just now, right? So theoretically speaking, the voltage gain AV value, or the ideal value of voltage gain for this common collector configuration, is actually equal to 1. Now, when this AV becomes 1, what will happen to this factor? This factor becomes RB by 0, or this actually, this factor will go to, this factor will actually go to infinity. So your Rn becomes beta plus 1 into small Re plus capital Re parallel with infinity, which is equal to the same value of beta plus 1 into small Re plus capital Re. All right. So just look, if you look back the circuit diagram, you will see that without the, you have placed a bootstrap capacitance here, and that bootstrap capacitor was initially kept open. That means there is no path from output back to input. At that condition, you saw that the input impedance is highly limited by the biasing resistors. But now what we can see is when you connect output back to input, thereby coupling the output back to this point through this bootstrap capacitor, we are actually increasing the input impedance to the previous, or we are restoring the input impedance to the input impedance of the common collector configuration, which is beta plus 1 into Re plus Re. Or even if we look at this expression, even if your AV is not equal to, and even if it is 0.8 or 0.9, still this value will be very high, whereby the input impedance will be definitely improved from the previous previous case. All right, so this is what you should know about emitter follower circuit. With the emitter follower circuit is basically this transistor and this resistance, but biasing part is required, and biasing part is basically limiting the input impedance, and in order to overcome that limitation, we are adding a bootstrap capacitor and connecting that from the output back to the input side. All right, this is about input impedance. Now, output impedance, nothing will happen. Output impedance will remain same, which will be same as what we have written, small Re parallel to capital Re, and voltage gain is also close to same. Now we will see how this circuit works in simulation. Now, before winding up, I'll also, let us quickly look at how the simulation works for this. That will be